were lucky to get away with some singed clothes. Others weren't so lucky.
The fateful few hours following the accident would seal the fate of Sodor Research.
Zephyr stopped us trying to put out the fire, insisting that any evidence would fall back on us.
Oh, you really should have called Fireman Sam, mate.
You knew the dangers. You're legally to blame. He stopped us calling for ambulances or the fire brigade.
We told him, these are injured people here. They're going to die unless we do something.
But he kept saying, no one from the outside can come in. No one can seize it.
Finally, someone suggested we airlift them to hospital. Harold was banned from flying for his own safety, but we thought the risk was worth it.
Fueling Harold was a nervous experience. Would he have the same reaction Mavis had?
We all breathed a sigh of relief and loaded the injured people aboard. Then it all went wrong.
Bex, oh no, it's flying out of control. No!
Harold's engine was worked fine, but what no one realized was most of Harold's lower extremities were permanently fused to his propeller system.
As Harold's rotor blades began to spin, vital organs would be drawn into the motor and tear him apart from the inside.
The smoke could be seen all morning, but news people were here in an instant. We were told to close gates and start clearing up the mess ourselves, with some help.
Henry Thierry was...
Help from who? Oh hey, it's Henry! Please don't say that something bad's happening
gonna
happen to him.
Working mostly at night, he would cart away the wreckage under cover of darkness.
We had to move quickly and quietly, and he would cart wreckage from the yard away to the sea. Then one night, the points were set wrong, and we were diverted to another shed.
Henry had inadvertently been sent to shed number 17, where Thomas had been biofused into a tank engine, and had subsequently been declared out of bounds.
It was dark, and these sheds all looked the same. I unlocked the doors and we rolled in. I didn't see what Henry saw, as soon as he put his head through doors, he bolted and reversed out.
Keith watched the shed up without seeing what was inside. But Henry had seen it all.
We wouldn't even dare talk about that shed, more than our jobs were.
But Henry had decided to speak up and confront Sir Topham Hatt. That night, he arrived at the railway controller's office.
I don't know what was said in there, but there were raised voices at times. He had a shouting match for 10 minutes, then Henry left, back to the shed.
By pure chance, he was sent back to the same shed as Thomas that night, and with one sentence, he sealed both their fates.
Henry only said one thing to him, stay away from shed 17. The next day, the fat had a new job for him.
The flying keeper
rolls
around
in action?
The night, drawing fish from the docks to the mainland. Across the highest altitude...
Okay. Snowing. Now what's going on?
But when Henry was put on there, in the middle of winter, it was a death trap.
In 1970, fish had started being delivered by road to the mainland. It was safer and more cost-effective, and the line was declared redundant. Dangerous and unnecessary, it came as a shock to the islanders.
Nice fishes.
That fat shit always hated
Henry. Now.
He didn't like his cheerful manner, and he clearly had other lifestyle choices when he was a human. F***ed wanted Henry away from the other engines, and Kipper Rump was a death sentence.
On the night of February the 8th, 1983, Henry had only been on the Kipper Run for a week. The following incidents would be made into a book and later recreated in the television series.
This is the train railway would call the Flying Kipper.
Can you believe they put it in a kid's story? Of course, that changed quite a few of the facts.
They couldn't know the clues from the mainland were siding the frozen, and the home signal should have been set at the danger. The snow had forced it down.
As the train approached the most treacherous part of the line, called notice to Henry, his driver and fireman. The points had diverted them to the adjoining siding and right into the path of another train.
No! He blew up! No! Oh.
Henry's driver and fireman had jumped clear before the crash.
In fact, Alan Barry died from their injuries.
Poor guy.
Slowly, in snow, the poor bastards.
Looks more like sand to me.
Sir Topham Hatt had arrived.
Cheer up, Henry, it wasn't your fault. Ice and snow caused the accident.
These images from a train spotter's camera were taken the evening before and were successfully covered up by the Sawdall Railway Board for 10 years.
There was a railway spike in points blocking them. Of course, that had disappeared by the time we got there.
I'm sending you to Crewe, a fine place for sick engines.
Crewe, we all knew what that meant.
They'll give you a new shape and a larger firebox.
Crewe was, at the time, one of only two scrap metal yards in the UK capable of handling and recycling organic material as well as engine parts.
You'll feel a different engine and won't need special coal anymore.
With those few words, it sentenced Henry to death.
Won't that be nice? Yes, sir, said Henry doubtfully.
Everyone knew he won't see him again. And everything was sewn up nice and neat for that fact.
Poor Henry.
Henry's accident. It didn't take long for Thomas to realise Henry had been disposed of because of what he knew.
The next evening, Thomas had been put on his own for the night at Knapford Station. As his driver and fireman left, under what was left of his own steam, he set off for the Sawdall Research Complex.
He had a small amount of burning fuel in his firebox, but he was mostly moving under his own strength. It took Thomas 3 hours to get to the complex, the effort to get there nearly killing him.
Thomas arrived at midnight. With no one around, he made his way to the shed where he was created. What he found was the answers to his questions, and many others.
Since Sawdall Research had become producing biofuels vehicles, the world had asked,
looks more like an asylum to me.
So well, but nearly every operation since had failed. Sadly, Thomas found the reasons inside.
Oh, what's this?
Thomas had never been the first operation.
It looked like a science victory. Second.
What shed number 17 contained was evidence of several attempts to create a...
No, not a spooky skeleton.
These have been early tests made by people with no experience.
No, my creepy face. I can't look.
Ill-planned and unprepared.
No, no, another spooky scary skeleton! Calm down, SpongeBob! Stop you seeing Halloween! A faceless tank engine!
Thomas the Tank Engine had been the Thomas we all knew as a boy. Part of the family the whole island's population had known and respected since Wilhelm first arrived.
In actuality, this tank engine was no more the real Thomas than all the failed creations made over the 12 months before.
This Thomas had all the human Thomas's memories and experiences. He had learned what Thomas had learned, known who Thomas had known, but so had all the previous failures.
Wilhelm and Hans Goetze had had to learn through trial and error how to bring their Thomas back from the dead. The following experiments had not had the same work put into them, resulting in the freak engines and aircraft, that had developed so many problems on Sodor Island and around the world. In Shed 17, Thomas wouldn't discover who he was, but in fact, who he wasn't.
Ooh! What's this? I wonder what's going on. Oh. What the? What was that? No, I can't watch. I can't watch. What the heck? No. I can't watch this. Oh no. Thomas is possessed. No. I can't watch this. Oh. No! His face fell off! No! Run for your lives! Ah! I'm out of here!
You have no idea he was only one of many clones. None of us did. But I guess as time passed,
oh.
I just don't ask it all the questions we
had. Oh, scary cats over there.
He could work for us. He became our servant in a way. Someone who grew in the crowds. Had great jobs. Was eager to work.
And I thought the THX logo was scary. I hate Thomas and Friends now. Well, I hope you enjoyed the video. Be sure to like, subscribe and comment. And happy Halloween, everyone.